position.
I don't know whether it's a hullabaloo down here, but there's a cracking atmosphere on the front straight. Everyone making their way to the front of the fences, everyone on their feet, and as if they sort of knew it was going to happen, the sun has broken out here at Mugello. It's an absolutely beautiful spectacle, this Tuscan scenery here in Mugello, and the sun is out. The Ducati stand are all standing with the red placards in the air. This is going to be a fantastic Italian Grand Prix.
Whoa, you can feel the atmosphere up here. Can Valentino Rossi make it a hat-trick of victories at Mugello? Can Sete Givinau make it a hat-trick of victories this season? Something's got to give. Who will it be? Perhaps it may even be this man, Max Biaggi, starting from the second row of the grid, chasing his first ever Premier Class win here at Mugello after winning three 250cc Grand Prix.
Struggled to find a setup here. Max Biaggi has had problems all weekend and really not quite lived up to the expectations and hopes that he had coming into this race. Remember, Max Biaggi, second in the championship, yet to win a Grand Prix this season, yet to win a Grand Prix at Mugello in his career, well, in the Premier Class career. And he really needs to pull something special out of the bag here this weekend if he's going to compete with these guys at the front. The balloons from the Ducati stand have just lifted and are just drifting across the sky in front of us, about 2,500 fans each letting off a balloon each there as they just drift across the circuit. What an atmosphere. I can see fireworks going off, I can see flares being shot across as there are those balloons. What a wonderful sight and what a wonderful occasion to be involved in.
Round four, the MotoGP World Championship, the finest circuit on the MotoGP calendar. We're at Mugello. It's the Italian Grand Prix. It's the home of Valentino Rossi. But there's a certain Spaniard by the name of Sete Givinau, an American by Nicky Hayden, who would like to dent his confidence and dent his national pride. Can they do it? Givinau, without a doubt, the man in form.
Two wins from three so far this season. Can Sete Givinau become the first man other than Valentino Rossi since Alex Crivier to win three Grand Prix races in a row?
The red flag is being shown. It's going to be 23 laps at this magnificent 5.24 kilometre, 3.259 mile Mugello circuit. This circuit is made for MotoGP racing. The lights are on red. The Italian Grand Prix is underway.
Good start from Nicky Hayden from the front row, just what he wanted. Good start as well from Max Biaggi up on the inside. What about Loris Capirossi coming through there from eighth on the grid? And it's going to be Capirossi. Is it to get the whole shot? No, it's Valentino Rossi.
Rossi leads the way. Looks like Biaggi in second place, Capirossi third, and perhaps Nicky Hayden in fourth place. But what a start by Valentino Rossi. The crowd are going absolutely wild here at Mugello. Rossi leads.
I'm not sure if that's Biaggi or Tomada who's through there in second place, but both Camel Hondas making an excellent start. They both look so similar. In fact, it is Biaggi who's up in second, Capirossi third from Hayden, Melandri, Tomada, Givinau from pole position getting swallowed up by the field. He's down in seventh place. Givinau's got some work to do. What a start, though, from Loris Capirossi. How long can he hang in there on the Ducati?
What a bad start by Sete Givinau. Down in seventh place, he's going to have to work mighty hard to get through this quality of field. There is Sete Givinau, down in seventh. Rossi leads, Biaggi, Capirossi, Hayden Melandri, Tomada, Givinau, Checker, and Kenny Roberts on the Suzuki in ninth place. This is where Rossi wanted to be.
Alex Barros has also made a dreadful start, Nick, as well, from the second row of the grid back down in 12th place. He was my tip for the podium. There he is on that number four Honda just behind Norik Abe. This is Abe on the number 17 Yamaha, teammate to Valentino Rossi, and Barros just behind him.
Well, deja vu up the front. Rossi and Biaggi slog it out in front of the Italian crowd in the sunshine here at Mugello. Still in third place, Loris Capirossi, and Nicky Hayden is desperate to get past Capirossi and get to those men at the front, and Givinau having to work hard in seventh place.
Here comes Marco Melandri up on the inside of Capirossi and Hayden. What a move from Melandri to go up to third place. He wants a piece of the action as well. Four Italians in the top four places now as they cross the line for the first time. Who's got the bigger drag down the straight? It's Biaggi who crosses the line first. Biaggi from Rossi. Capirossi just manages to outstrip Melandri on the Ducati down the straight. But Melandri late on the brakes at the end of the straight. This is Nicky Hayden. We're on board here with Sete Givinau, the pole position, man. He's tucked in now behind Loris Capirossi and Hayden. Hayden gets back in front of Capirossi as they go through these sweeping section of left and right. Poggio Secchio past the banks of fans of Valentino Rossi's fan club. There they are in the background, and their rider leads the way.
There is Loris Capirossi now coming under real pressure from Sete Gibernau. Gibernau doesn't want those men to get away at the front. Rossi heads the way. Biaggi, Marco Melandri, Tomada, Nicky Hayden backing in that rear wheel. Loris Capirossi, Sete Gibernau. There is Norik Abbe. Not a bad start by Norik Abbe over, but it's his teammate Valentino Rossi that leads the way.
Colin Edwards, Nick, as well, meanwhile, getting a dreadful start. He was way down in 12th on the grid, and he's lost a couple of places. In fact, he's down in 14th behind Ruben Jaus. So Edwards really struggling here this weekend. We'll talk a bit more about that later on. But here comes his teammate Sete Gibernau up on the inside of Loris Capirossi. Capirossi's great start. We knew that Ducati were having problems. It couldn't last forever. But Capirossi has now just been picked off by the field, and Gibernau's making his way through. The crowd are absolutely on their feet already. We've only had, what, 1.5 laps of this Italian Grand Prix. But it's exceeding expectations already, certainly for Valentino Rossi, who leads the way after starting from third on the grid.
Up towards Puccini, the left-hander that comes into the start and finish straight. They come onto that start and finish straight in second gear, and then they just open the throttle, get their heads behind the fairing. When they reach the top of the hill, they're fourth gear now, fifth gear, absolutely flat out. 210 miles an hour through the speed trap now. And then who's bravest on the brakes? Biaggi goes up the inside. Biaggi's got the better position as they brake for the right-hander in second gear. No, Rossi just holds for looking to Tomada. And Melandri has come through on Tomada. So Melandri third. Tomada having a great ride in fourth place where he finished last year. Just got a glimpse there of Nicky Hayden. And Gibernau closing all the time there on Nicky Hayden. But Rossi is on fire at the front.
The late braking there from Marco Melandri, you have to see it to believe it. He was absolutely outstripped by the Honda of Tomada down the straight, but braked as late as possibly you probably can coming into that right-hander at the end of the straight to reclaim third place and close the gap, in fact, on Biaggi. Here we are on board with Marco Melandri, and he is getting all over the back of Max Biaggi now as they come through these fast-sweeping Casanova and Savelli and down into the two quick right-handers, Arrabbiata 1 and 2.
And of course, Marco Melandri, also a former winner here, former 250cc winner here. He's had a mixed year, but he's shown glimpses this year, Marco Melandri, of greatness, I think, as a MotoGP rider. What a ride this would be, and he really is closing on Max Biaggi. He's right behind Biaggi, and at the glimpse, just get a glimpse of the blue and the sunshine of the helmet there of Valentino Rossi. Fourth place, Makoto Tomada. Nicky Hayden battling his way back in fifth place. And there is Sete Gibernau in sixth place. He's caught up the pack. He's had to work very, very hard to do that. He's probably used a little bit more tyre than he would have wanted to. Certainly a lot more energy than he would have wanted to. And these leading six have broken away.
Just watch the Hondas down the straight. This is where we expected them to have the edge. When they come round this final right-hander, watch Biaggi and Tomada just open the gas. Sete Gibernau as well, and Nicky Hayden behind there. Just watch the advantage they have on the Yamaha. They'll come up through, and it just seems that Rossi and Melandri, the only way they can be in front at the end of this straight is on the brakes. Just watch them now as Tomada just eases past Marco Melandri as they come down the straight for the top time.
Yeah, Tomada outstripping Melandri once again down the straight. The fastest lap of the race so far from Tomada, but here comes Melandri on the brakes once more. Up on the inside, tips it in. Not quite close enough this time. Tomada just having that extra speed at the end of the straight to hold off the young Italian. Brave stuff from Marco Melandri, though, in fourth place.
Rossi still leads the way. The two Hondas right behind him, the yellow Hondas of Max Biaggi and Makoto Tomada. And Marco Melandri, as we've seen, an absolute demon on the brakes. Nicky Hayden still in fifth place. And in sixth place, it's Sete Gibernau, the championship leader, who made such a bad start from pole position. We ride with Rossi.
Alex Barros, Nick, he's worked his way up from 10th place up to 7th, but he's almost 3 seconds down on Sete Gibernau, who's at the back of this lead group, and this resembles a 1-2-5cc race here. Six riders bunched together, and then a gap down to Alex Barros in 7th place.
What about a mention about Makoto Tomada? First time he saw the circuit here last year, he finished 4th in the race. He really does like this circuit. He's 3rd at the moment. And he is all over the rear wheel of his teammate, Max Biaggi. And you get the feeling if he gets past him, he's going to have a go at the man at the front, Valentino Rossi. What a ride by Rossi. There we are, 16.5-inch front, 16.5-inch rear Michelin tyres. And that, is that Carlos Checa out of the race? It is. Checa is out of the race. It looks like a fall for Carlos Checa.
Yeah.
But Oh, he's had a tough old weekend. He looks so on form, but as so often happens with Carlos Checa, just when it appears to be going right, it all goes wrong. Givinau now closing.
Here comes Nicky Hayden up on the inside of Marco Melandri, up through to fourth place there. Nicky Hayden on a bit of a charge as well. Now then, three Hondas stalk Rossi down the straight. Two of them are yellow and they're ridden by Max Biaggi and Makoto Tomada. Tomada comes up on the inside of his teammate now down at the end of the straight. Will Tomada now outbreak Max Biaggi into the right-hander? He will. Makoto Tomada is going to get up to second place. He hangs on, shoves Biaggi wide, and Nicky Hayden might take advantage. He can't quite. Nicky Hayden held off into fourth place. In fact, it's Marco Melandri who somehow got past Hayden at the end of the straight. No doubt that late braking that we saw from him on the previous couple of laps. But Tomada is now up to second place and he's got Rossi in his sights.
Ooh, I shouldn't think Max Biaggi would be too happy about that. He opened the door really for Melandri. He didn't quite get through. Melandri, as Gavin pointed out, absolute demon on the brakes there. But Rossi still leads the way. He looks behind him. It's a yellow bike. I bet he thinks it's Max Biaggi. It's not. It's Makoto Tomada. Tomada having a great ride in second place. Biaggi still in third spot. But we ride with Max Biaggi. Right behind him, Marco Melandri, again a former 250cc world champion. And then the two Hondas of Nicky Hayden and Sete Givinau. Givinau has caught up with this leading bunch. And it does appear that nobody's able to break the bunch, doesn't it? I mean, perhaps if Tomada got in front, he may be able to with that speed of the Honda. Certainly Ross isn't able to break the bunch, and it's going to come down to tactics. But Tomada now, you just get the feeling Tomada wants to take the lead. He wants to lead a Grand Prix, and he's going to have a real go at doing exactly that. We ride with Sete Givinau in sixth place. In front of him, Nicky Hayden on the Repsol Honda. And Givinau doesn't want those men to get away at the front after he made such a poor start from pole position.
More problems for Proton KR. Curtis Roberts involved in an Italian barbecue yesterday when his bike caught fire. He was so lucky then, and he's had to retire from the race now. He comes into the pit lane. A sad end to the day for Curtis Roberts, the American.
Well, Roberts' former AMA Superbike sparring buddy, Nicky Hayden, is going at it with Marco Melandri. He's up into fourth place, but here comes Makoto Tomada at the end of the straight. Outstrips Rossi, but Rossi on the brakes. Rossi doing all he knows to hold off Makoto Tomada into the right-hander. Just about does it. Nicky Hayden shoved wide by the combined efforts of Givinau and Melandri, and Nicky Hayden now bumped back down to sixth.
Let's get this absolutely right. They are travelling at 210 miles an hour there, 338 kilometres an hour, and braking down to 60 miles an hour, down through the gearbox, on the brakes. Rossi, so brave. And here's Melandri again having a go with Nicky Hayden.
Nicky
Hayden. What a race.
Nicky Hayden's rear wheel coming off the ground there as he braked to try and get back at Marco Melandri. Look at Valentino Rossi. He has a look at Makoto Tomada as he goes past him and thinks, right then, I'm going to get you at the end of the straight. Here's Nicky Hayden getting in all sorts of shapes with that Honda, really sliding it around, working it hard to get back at Melandri, but just maybe now losing pace with these guys at the front.
Sete Givinau quietly and almost unbeknown to anybody else is joining in, isn't he? He's now right behind Max Biaggi and he is absolutely flying. Now, it's a long, long way to go to the end of the race, but where will Rossi want to be as they come onto that final straight if he's in this position? Because you've got to say, if he's in this position and they go into that final straight, the Honda is going to beat him, isn't he? So it's going to be very, very tactical.
He is, but Nick, you know, if he's in second place, he could get beaten as well. It's so hard to call there because the Hondas have such a horsepower advantage, it seems, coming down that straight. And it's not just going into the straight, as we're going to see it once again here as they tip into the left-hander, as Nicky Hayden once again gets up on the inside of Marco Melandri. He likes it there as they come into this tight left that brings them back into the start-finish straight. But just here, as we watch Nicky Hayden and Marco Melandri now, you can't really tell on the TV, but that's a steep hill as they come up there into the straight. Here comes Max Biaggi getting in front of Valentino Rossi. So we've got two Camel Hondas now leading the way. Makoto Tomada getting in front of Valentino Rossi and getting ahead of myself here, giving Biaggi the lead when he's actually in third place behind Rossi. Givinau fourth, Nicky Hayden crossed the line in fifth place. I'm not sure whether Marco Melandri will have got past him again on the brakes at the end of the straight there. We'll wait and find out. But there's a steep hill coming into that straight, and that's where the horsepower counts, particularly at the bottom end of the power range, which is where the Yamaha tends to lose out to these Hondas.
And Tomada got past Rossi that time, and then he didn't let him out, break him into the right-hander. Tomada leads away. Rossi is all over him. Rossi tries to go up the inside. Rossi is up the inside. Valentino Rossi, to the cheers of the hillside, leads the race, but Tomada has come up alongside him again, and Tomada is back in the lead. What a race at the front, but while this goes on, Biaggi and Givinau are closing all the time. Givinau really looking threatening now in fourth place. There's no doubt about it. Rossi wants to get past Tomada as quickly as he can. He's up the inside again. This time, surely, Rossi's going to go through. Yeah, listen to the crowd. They are going wild. Rossi leads the way once again on the Yamaha. Tomada in second place. Biaggi and Givinau. I think these four have broken away.
Nicky Hayden. Nicky Hayden's gone down. Hayden was fighting with Melandri for fifth place. We're on board there with the American. He's going to get back on track, but where he will be, I'm not sure. Marco Melandri is now on his own in fifth place.
Tomada still fighting off the challenge there of Valentino Rossi. Rossi coming under pressure there from Biaggi and Givinau. They're into the left-hander. Rossi takes the lead. But Rossi knows when they get up to top speed, 210 miles an hour, 338 kilometers an hour it was yesterday. At about this point, not quite now, side by side, Tomada will lead the way. Now will Rossi try to position himself to get past on the brakes? Here comes Biaggi as well. This is at over 200 miles an hour. Now they're starting to break down through the gearbox, fourth gear.
Sete Givinau on the inside of Max Biaggi as well, shoves Biaggi wide into the right-hander. Second gear, 60 miles an hour into that right-hander, and Givinau moves up to third place, but it's Tomada who leads the way. Here comes Rossi in front of his fans, all banked up there to the left. You get a glimpse of them now. Rossi in front of his fans club, thousands of them packed into that part of the stand as they come through the Poggio Secchio corner. Tried to make a pass on Tomada again, not quite this time.
Well, you know why? He knows who's right behind him. You've got to say, the man of the race so far, two men of the race really, Tomada and Givinau. Tomada at the front. Here comes Rossi again. He knows Givinau is there, and he knows that he can probably take Tomada there. He did it at the last time. Now, can Rossi hang on to the lead? No, he can't. Tomada just bashes it back in front of him. And all the time, Sete Givinau just sucks in his breath and says, "Rod, I've had to work mighty hard to get there." But Sete Givinau wants to join in the fun. Here comes Givinau, almost up the inside of Rossi. They're almost side by side. Rossi on the brakes again. Tomada leads. Rossi second. Givinau third. Biaggi in fourth place. If it gets better than this, tell me where.
Up this slight hill they come then into the tight right-hander. And it's Tomada just holding them off. This is the Corrential turn where the Ducati fans are banked, and then it's through this Biondetti chicane.
I'm just down here in pit lane at the moment with John Hopkins. We talked about him earlier, not riding because of a broken thumb here this weekend. But John, Tomada in the lead. What's the tyre life? What problems is he going to have with those Bridgestones as we go through this race?
Actually, I don't see any problems going on. Right now, you know, from first-hand experience, the Bridgestones, the durability on the Bridgestones are just amazing. You're really going to see him coming on strong, and the Bridgestones are going to really be working good at the end of the race, that's for sure.
Just got to cut in momentarily, Gavin, because Sete Givinau has gone past Valentino Rossi. Max Biaggi has gone past Valentino Rossi. Rossi in fourth place. Tomada leads. Givinau second. Biaggi third. Rossi four. Please carry on.
Yeah, just we can see there again that the Hondas just seem to have it on the straight. We always knew that was going to be the case. The Yamahas may be quicker through that part of the track. Is that how you see it? And you think Rossi has got a chance to be up there?
Yeah, you know, Rossi is really having to work hard. You know, he has been all year long. The Hondas, they definitely got the straight, you know, the power down the straights. But like I said, the Bridgestones, those are going to really be coming in at the end of the race. And, you know, Rossi, he's a player, you know. He's going to wait till the end of the race. And Sete, he's the man to watch right now because he's just been on fire all weekend.
Okay, thanks for that, John. John just confirmed as well he's going to be riding in Barcelona, so that's good news. Thanks a lot, John.
Okay, John Hopkins missing out this weekend with a broken thumb. We look forward to seeing him back in action in Barcelona in a week's time. But as he rightly said, the man on fire at the moment this weekend is undoubtedly Sete Givinau. He smashed the pole record here by 1.7 seconds. On Friday afternoon, and he's on a charge now, and he's putting Makoto Tomada under some serious pressure. Things just settling down a little bit now. Givinau will prefer it this way. He's worked his way steadily up to second place, and if he can get past Tomada and start setting his rhythm, then these guys might just be stretched out and broken, because it's been so combative and so elbow to elbow over the first part of this race. But I don't think Givinau would have wanted that too much, because he has had a superior pace over the course of the weekend.
quickly run through the field for you. Tomato, Rossi, Chibanao, Biaggi, Melandri, Barros, 6, 7, Edwards, 8, Abbe, 9, Roberts, 10, Staus. The 12th in place is Troy Bayliss as they cross the line. Caparossi, Nakano, Hodgson, McWilliams in 15th place. But you can't take your eyes off this battle at the front. And Tomato still leads the way. Chibanao second, Biaggi third, and Rossi in fourth place. But this is where Rossi makes his move. This is where the Yamaha is quick and nimble through these very fast section of chicanes. And this is where Rossi will try and get past Biaggi, because he knows when they get on that straight, he has definitely got a horsepower disadvantage.
Top marks to Alex Barros. We talked about how much of a bad start he had, but he's up and he's past Marco Melandri now. Up into fifth position. He's absolutely flying. If it wasn't for that bad start, I say he will have been up there. And Matt's pre-race prediction would have come true, but Valentino Rossi making him another move now. He's not down out yet, is he, Valentino Rossi?
He's up to third place. He's got past Max Biaggi once more, to the delight of his fans here. But you're right, Gav, about Alex Barros. And chatting to his chief mechanic, Ramon Forsada, this weekend, he was saying that Barros's big problem this year so far has been his starts. He's been having a really good race pace and building it up in the race. Let's just keep our eye on Valentino Ross. What a move there on Sete Givinau. This is absolutely... Well, Rossi, he's been stung into action, hasn't he? He's been passed by Biaggi, Givinau and Tomato. He doesn't like it. He's back up to second as they come up then through Arrabbiata once more. Through the Corentao once more and into this Biondetti chicane. Rossi is right on it once again.
From that onboard, you can probably see the clouds looming in the background. There's been a cloud just fallen all over the circuit. That's obviously going to help the Bridgestones because of the cooler track temperatures.
Rossi takes the lead, Gavin. Rossi takes the lead at the left-hander coming into the start and finish straight. Rossi leads again. Tomato second, Chibanao three, Biaggi four. Please keep an eye on the weather. And please, please put your hands together. We don't want any rain because this is MotoGP at its very best as Tomato leads the way over the line.
Look at the horsepower advantage, and Rossi gets in all sorts of a wobble at the end of the straight, but he still manages to outbreak Tomato. Rossi back into the lead, Biaggi around the outside. He's not close enough. Givinau almost touches with Tomato. It's absolute chaos at the end of that straight, but the man hanging on is the man in the lead, the world champion, Valentino Rossi, putting on an absolutely stunning performance for his army of crowd. Here they are, banked up behind him in the Poggio Secco corner. He breaks now for the Materassi left-right-hander through Borgo San Lorenzo and down towards Casanova. He is a bit of a Casanova himself, Valentino Rossi, and he looks comfortable through this corner as he leads Makoto Tomato.
How many laps to go? 12 and a half. I've looked at the other screen for about half an hour. 12 and a half laps to go. Rossi leads the way. We thought this was going to be a great race. This is a superb race. And without a doubt, the Yamaha is not as good as the Hondas at this circuit. Rossi somehow makes it work. Sad day, though, for the former world champion, Kenny Roberts, drops out of the race in the Suzuki. It's the sole Suzuki representative at the weekend. And I'm afraid Kenny Roberts and Suzuki out of the race here at Mugello. Meanwhile, Rossi leads. Tomato second. Chibanao third. Biaggi just dropping off a little bit. Is he in fourth place? Let's have a look. Yeah, just a little bit. And Givinau, you feel, has done a lot of hard work to get there. And perhaps now just having a bit of a breather.
Yeah, it looks as though the pace has been stepped up by Rossi on this lap, Nick. It had dropped into the 152s, on the previous lap. We know that the race pace here is going to be around the mid-151 mark, maybe a couple of low 151s when the pace really hots up. The pace on the previous lap, as I say, a 152.4 from Makoto Tomato. This time it's Rossi with a 151.2, Tomato a 151.3, but gets Rossi as they cross the line once more. This time they're on the brakes. This time, another time, it's Rossi who's the bravest, and Rossi just hangs on to that lead. But as I said, the time's now dropping into the low 51s where we know they can go.
Well, I think Rossi's only tactic can be is to go as quick as he can to try to break them up, because he knows if it's going to be this close with the Hondas, he's going to have problems, isn't he, on the last lap coming into that straight and on that straight. So he's going to try and break it. I think we're going to see some very quick laps now from him. The Tomato's hanging in there. Givinau's hanging in there. It's just Biaggi just a little bit dropping off the pace. Barros still in fifth place. Melandri sixth. Edwards seventh. Abbe eighth. Ninth is Troy Bayliss. 10th is Rubens Chaus. 11th is Nakano. 12th is Caparossi. 13th Hoffman. 14th, the World Superbike Champion, Neil Hodgson. And in 15th place, Shane Shaky Byrne, the British Superbike Champion, with Jeremy McWilliams in 16th place.
On board here with Sete Givinau, the championship leader, currently tucked behind Makoto Tomada in third place, and Max Biaggi, Nick, just dropping off the pace slightly off the back of Gibbonauer.
Nicky Hayden coming into the pit. Sorry, Nicky Hayden looks like he's going to be retiring from this one. We saw him crash out, and Hayden's going to come into the pits. Real disappointment for the former AMA Superbike champion. In he comes. What a sad end to the day for him.
Huge disappointment for Nicky Hayden after starting from second on the grid. His best ever Grand Prix qualifying performance and dicing it out with these guys over the opening laps. But that crash, as he just lost pace a little bit with them, putting an end effectively to his weekend. But just keeping an eye on the lap times once more as they kick up through the hill and down this straight. No doubt we will see Makoto Tomada drift out of the slipstream of Rossi once again, and then it will be onto the brakes once more. Who's it going to be this time? It's been Rossi the last few times. Can it be Tomada this time? He's got the advantage. He's got the outside line though. Rossi's got the inside. Tomada just tries to swing his Honda across the front of Valentino Rossi. He manages it somehow, and Valentino Rossi gets him back. Down through the left-hander, Luco, and then it's through this right-hander, Poggio Secco. That's where Rossi doesn't want to be overtaken. It's where his fans are, but Tomada doesn't care. He's got back in front of Valentino Rossi. Rossi onto the brakes, into Materazzi, the left-hander, back into the lead through Borgo San Lorenzo, the right-hander, and down once more to Casanova they go.
Wow, this is just superb. Interestingly enough, Rossi just had a big enough advantage as Gibbonau goes up into second place. He's got past Tomada. I think he feels Rossi is too quick at the front. He's not going to let him get away. Interestingly enough, when they went over the start and finish line, Rossi had a big enough advantage on the Yamaha to actually lead Tomada over the line.
I think Tomada may have gone off. I think he may have gone off at the first corner.
No, Tomada's there, Gav. He's there in there.
The camel team are running about. They're all running out of the track, looking down. There's yellow flags being waved at the first corner. I'm not sure what's going on there. There's something going on at the side of the track.
Oh, it's Shinya Nakano who's down. They've got his helmet off. He looks to be okay. He's waved to the crowd. And no, Makoto Tomada definitely in there. But that was a nasty crash at 200 miles an hour. And I'm not surprised the Camel Honda team were so worried, Gav, because that is absolutely horrendous for Shinya Nakano, but luckily he's okay. The Camel Honda team right at the end of pit lane there would have seen that. They would have seen him heading towards that concrete wall and they would have feared the worst. But Nakano has given a wave. He seems to be okay, and thank goodness.
210 miles an hour there. That was a mighty big accident right back at the front. The world champion against the championship leader, the Yamaha against the Honda, the Spaniard against the Italian. The Italian that leads away, but Gibbonau comfortably gets up the inside of Valentino Rossi on the fastest part of the circuit. Rossi knows exactly what to do. He tries to pull back inside on the brakes of Senna Gibbonau. He can't do it. Oh, Makoto Tomada is out of the race. Oh, what a ride by the Japanese Honda rider. He's out of the race with a mechanical problem. There are three left to battle it out. Now, Senna Gibbonau, I'm sure, is going to try and break the resolve of Valentino Rossi. Here, now, and immediately.
That's surely what he's going to try and do, Nick, with, what, 9.5 laps to go. He knows he had the pace over the weekend. It was superior to everybody else out there. Gibbonau, as I said, setting that pole record. A man to keep an eye out for at the moment is Alex Barros. He was absolutely way down in the field after the start, down in 10th place. He's fought his way through. He's up now to 4th place behind Max Biaggi, around 2 seconds behind Biaggi. I think Biaggi has just stepped up his pace slightly, but previous to that, Barros was just chipping away at Biaggi, taking a few tenths off him on each lap. And with 10 seconds to go, if he can keep doing that, and if he can just try and put some pressure on Biaggi, then he may be able to challenge for that final podium position.
9.5 to go. Gibbonau leads the way. Rossi trying all he knows to hang with him, but you've got to say, the odds are now favoured towards the Spaniard on the Honda. But as we've seen from Rossi, he can just pull something extra out when it really, really matters. Biaggi looking more comfortable now in third place and really hasn't let them get too far away. But we've just got a glimpse there of the man absolutely flying. That's Alex Barros in fourth place. But Rossi's going to have to produce something that we've not even seen from Valentino Rossi previously. We ride with Sete Gibbonau, the Telefonica movie star Honda, over the line. 210 miles an hour. The front wheel just lifts off the ground, even at that sort of speed. Now on the brake, absolutely loaded onto the front end, down to 60 miles an hour, six to fourth gear, round the right-hander. We ride with the championship leader, we ride with the race leader, and Rossi is trying absolutely everything he knows to stay with him. This is the battle with Colin Edwards, Troy Bayliss, two former World Superbike champions, and Norik Abbe. It's a battle for sixth place.
And at the moment, it's been won by Colin Edwards. Norik Abbe now in seventh, Troy Bayliss in eighth. the two former World Superbike sparring partners getting involved there with Noricabe. Marco Melandri, meanwhile, is currently lapping in fifth place quite comfortably on the Yamaha. So a good ride from Marco Melandri. And now we have a real battle at the front between Gibbonau and Rossi, and it's just Rossi, is it now? Rossi leading, he's snatched it back from Sete Gibbonau at a crucial point of this race where Sete Gibbonau was just looking to break the world champion, and Rossi, as we saw him do at Velkom in round one, is riding beyond even his own limits. He's riding beyond the limits of any human on that bike, that's for sure.
Well, I thought Gibbonau had got away. Rossi's the man that likes to prove everybody wrong. He's done it once again. There we are. That's how close it is. We ride with Gibbonau. There is Rossi absolutely alongside us. And they tip it in the right hander. You're going to see Rossi, I would imagine, just come up the inside. You do. Rossi still leads. Gibbonau second. 8.5 laps to go. What a race we have. And Gibbonau, very, very close indeed. He knows the extra horsepower of the Honda as he comes out of this bend will take him into the lead. But what will Rossi do? Rossi will get as close as he can at the end of the straight and then trying to outbrake him, and they break, as we say, from 210 to 60 miles an hour. It's the toughest braking area in any MotoGP circuit. Side by side, Gibbonau will take the advantage. We know that on the Honda. Now, who's bravest on the brakes? Rossi is well positioned on the brakes. Up the inside goes Rossi. Oh, he just rushes Gibbonau aside.
Interestingly there, Nick, Rossi had the advantage as they crossed the finish line. It was very, very close, but by around 1/100 of a second, it went to Rossi, and that's the key point at this point of the circuit, because, as we said, it's a short drag up the hill and across the line, and even though the Honda has the advantage by the end of the straight, if Rossi can just squeeze enough horsepower out of that Yamaha, if he leads into that corner, then he might just be able to do enough. He did it on that previous lap.
If Rossi wins this race, we probably won't be talking to you from Barcelona, because I think we'll still be stuck in the circuit. They are going wild on the hillside. And no wonder why. This is a supreme performance by a great motorcycle racer. And Sete Gibbonau is matching him all the way. This is at its very best. A head-to-head between the two best riders in the world at any level, in any competition. There's no doubt about that. Who's going to be the victor at the end? It would take a brave man to forecast just that. But it's going to be a mighty close race as they come along. Now break for the right-hander before they come into that twisty section and then the vital left into the starting field.
Just watch out for Alex Barros. He's making constant progress on Max Biaggi. The gap's down to 1.9 seconds halfway around this lap. Just watch the Brazilian. He really is making progress as Biaggi drops off from these front two, and he's certainly one to watch at the moment.
Well, just some debris down on the track in front of us on the start-finish straight, and the marshals have been running out to clear it off. I'm not sure where that's been coming from, but the track is clear as Rossi and Gibbonau once again come side by side down the start-finish straight. And once again, it's Rossi who had the advantage over the line. And is it going to be Rossi who has the advantage into the corner? It's Gibbonau who has the better line. He's on the inside. Rossi and Gibbonau almost touch, and Gibbonau just hangs on with seven laps to go.
Very, very interesting indeed that he's getting across the line first if he's leading the way, Rossi. But Gibbonau now leads the way. Rossi right on his tail. The Honda versus the Yamaha. The race we wanted to see. The race that everybody wanted to see. Gloves off. Two great riders. Oh, look at Rossi there. Flicks it left, flicks it right, and takes the lead. Gibbonau absolutely somehow. They touched elbows then. They touched elbows. And Sete Gibbonau leads the way. He's run it wide. Rossi tries to get up the inside, then the outside. Doesn't do so. They actually touched elbows. Here comes Rossi again. He's all over the rear wheel of the Honda. Gibbonau just holds firm fast. He's very, very fast. Arapeata, right-hander. What a race between the two best riders in the world. I'm sorry, I keep telling you, it just doesn't get better. This, here comes Rossi again on the brakes, and he's gone through again. Listen to the crowd.
Through Scarperia, then left through Palagio and down towards this Corentile corner where the Ducati fans are banked. They've not had too much to cheer about here this weekend, the Ducati fans, but I'm sure they're enjoying this now as they watch their compatriot Valentino Rossi lead the Italian Grand Prix. They come down towards this Biondetti chicane. This is where Rossi is so strong, flicking it first left and then right and then down towards this long left-hander that brings them back into the start-finish straight.
Let's watch this again. They definitely touch elbows. Here we go. point of contact, just about, didn't they? Just about touched.
Whoa, more than just about. I think they're jibbing out. It seemed to me just leaned into Rossi just a little bit to let him know he was there. Now then, Rossi has a clear advantage this time. He's had the advantage every time as they cross that finish line for the last three laps. Is Givinal just holding off slightly on that throttle? Is he keeping something up his sleeve for that last lap? Because there's no doubt about it now with six laps to go. This is going all the way to the wire.
Yeah, perhaps he is holding something in reserve. I think you might be right. He might not be showing his full deck of cards at the moment. We ride with Sete Givinal. The man in front of him, Valentino Rossi, so quick through this succession of fast chicanes. You won't see a man ride better or quicker through this succession of fast corners, and Givinal is right with him. Rossi just lets the rear end of that Yamaha slide out a little bit under the rumble strip. Looks very comfortable there at the moment.
I'm just on pit wall at the moment with Mick doing. Mick, call this one, go on.
It's a tough one, isn't it? Valentino's definitely not going to give in though, is he? His tyres look to be a little bit shot compared to as steady as Sete looks anyway, but six laps to go. It's Italy. I'd hate to call it, really.
Valentino's got to be first into the final corner, hasn't he? He's got to be coming out of there. Is that the only way he can do it?
Well, at the moment, he seems to be able to pass him in a few different areas, but we don't know whether this is all that Sete's got. Well, I guess, really, I think three laps to go and we'll see who's got what, really. I think at the moment, they're just sort of hanging in there. Sete looks quite comfortable. If he comes fast, Valentino can get back by. But as I say, with three laps to go, I don't think there'll be any messing around. It'll just be see who can win.
Okay, we'll take Mick's word for it. We don't know what's going to happen. Okay, back to you, boys.
Yeah, he's always a bit tight with his money, Mick, wasn't he? He wasn't going to put that on anybody, was he? And I don't blame him at all, but obviously he reads the race better than anybody else.
One thing you can't read, though, is what's going on in the minds of these two at the moment, Valentino Rossi and Sete Givinal.
Drops of rain coming at Mugello, spitting at the moment. I don't know whether that's going to be enough to stop it. Of course, if they stop it with any more than one lap to go, this race will be stopped and started again for a three-lap shootout, or five laps if it stopped around about now.
Well, we'll wait and find out for the moment. They're still going at it. We may see Valentino raise his hand, and he has. There goes Valentino Rossi's hand to point towards the rain. And I'm sure that Givinal won't try anything now. He's also recognised the rain. It's down to the race leader. Rossi says it's raining, and surely now this race is going to be stopped.
It's up to the race director, and he looks to be getting out the red flag. Yep, the red flag is out from the race director. I'm bang underneath him at the moment, just seeing him raise that red flag.
Well, I tell you what, Gav, you're down there, you can see it. We're looking out of the commentary box window here, and to me, it looks like a big solitary black cloud that's just drifted across here. We've got blue sky on the way once again. We could have another dry shootout after this.
Yeah, that's what it's going to be. I think the fans on the straight aren't really aware of that at the moment because they're all cheering. They believe Rossi to be the winner.
Well, this is late dramatic because, you know, The grid is going to be reformed here. It doesn't matter about the aggregate times. That's got absolutely nothing to do with it. These guys are going to be put together on the grid, and we're going to have Valentino Rossi from Sete Givinal, Max Biaggi on the front row, then Barros Melandri and Bayliss on the second row, and it's going to be a five-lap shootout. If Mick Doohan was finding this difficult to call before, it's going to be even more difficult to call now.
I'm on the floor. Oh, what a shame. What a real, real shame, because that was a good as race as I think I've seen for a very, very long time. Well done, Valentino Rossi. You've thrilled us many, many times, but this was as good as it gets. And he still has a chance. How can you do that when you've been racing like that? Now the rain's coming down. It's Sete Givinal. So it's going to be a five-lap shootout. I just want to get this absolutely right. A five-lap shootout. Can they change tyres? Yes, they can, can't they?
Yeah, they can change tyres. You know, that's the idea, that they come in because it's raining. And yep. You know, they can change wet tyres. Well, they can change slick tyres. I'm not sure if there's a rule about that.
I don't think there is. They can put on what they like, I suppose. I don't know if it's warranted enough to use any intermediate tyres at the moment. There is a bit of rain falling now. I'm sure they'll just go on to some hand-cut slick tyres. That seems what it probably will be, but the riders can make changes, do what they like to the bike, take the fuel out, put in as much as they need for the remaining amount of laps. But just think of the rhythm. Valentino Rossi and Sete Givinal have been going at it, hammer and tongs throughout the entire race. and now they've got to pick themselves up again, go out for another start, and they've got to have another race, and they've got to pick up that rhythm again. It gives the likes of Biaggi, Barros, such a big chance to get back up there again.
Yeah, particularly Barros, because he was taking a couple of tenths off Max Biaggi with each lap, but with six laps to go, it wasn't quite going to be enough. He was around 1.8 seconds behind him. Now he's going to be next to him on the grid.
Right, I have to say, it's going to be a six-lap race. It's going to be a six-lap shootout because not everyone have completed that final lap. So six-lap race. We don't know when it's going to start, and the rain is starting to come down a lot harder now. So now it's going to be a much more difficult decision about which tyres they have to use because the rain is starting to pour down here at Mugello.
There, it's going to start in 21 minutes' time. Then the six-lap Italian Grand Prix. Great call, Gavin. You got that absolutely spot on. And Rossi told Gibernau, didn't he? He told him. It didn't look like, I thought it almost looked like a thumbs up, but he was pointing up to the sky, wasn't he? Just to let him know exactly what was going on. Oh, that is so, so sad. What a race. Hey, the next bit, the next six laps may be great, but I don't think anything will be as good as what we've just witnessed. And there's Speedo Carmelet. Oh, God, I can't get the man's name right, Gavin. Matthew, explain to me. I'm too excited, I tell you. It's like that advert. I'm too excited, I can't sleep. But no, that was absolutely fabulous and a great, great disappointment. Obviously, the race has to be stopped because of the rain, because they're on slick tyres. And as we saw the accident to Shinya Nakano, I was very happy to see when we were talking to Mick Doohan, it came up on the bottom of the screen that he's conscious and he's in the medical centre. And Mike Trimby, the president of IRTA, just explaining to the riders exactly what is going to go on.
Just to break in there, Nick, just confirmed as well, just to confirm, so anybody watching, bit confused about what's going on, yeah. Because the rain has come, we're going to have a six-lap shootout. The grid is going to be formed by the positions they finished the last complete lap in, so we're going to have Rossi, Gibernau, Biaggi, Barros, they're going to be at the front of this grid. And the race cannot be stopped again. That's really crucial point to make. We can't stop again if more rain comes. So tyre choice is final. There's no stopping again for any wetter conditions. If it starts to pour it down and you've got slicks on, or if you've got your cut that slicks on, then it's your own fault, I'm afraid. They have to make the decision. It's a very tough decision they've got to make. There's Michelin engineers, Dunlop, Bridgestone engineers running up and down the pit lane at the moment, just deciding what tyres they're going to use. And as I say, it can't be stopped now. Six races to the line.
Wow. Oof.
And let's just also make it clear, there's no adding up of aggregate times from the first leg or the second leg. What has gone on, what you've just witnessed, means absolutely nothing now, I'm afraid. That counts for nothing. All that effort put in by those riders counts for nothing. It's going to be a six-lap shootout. And what a shootout it's going to be. Now, the riders who are out of the race obviously can't come back into it. That's another thing, isn't it?
Yeah, obviously, unless they crash on the lap,
yeah.
When it started to rain. I fancy Marco Melandri to have a go at this as well. We saw the way he started that race. We've seen him several times this year really go for it in the opening laps and last year, and then just slow down in the second half of the rain. There's Colin Edwards and his wife Alicia. Colin clearly quite happy about the situation as well. He gets a second bite of the cherry here at Mugello after a disappointing weekend. To be honest, you know, with Colin, he was 14th, I think, after the first lap. He worked his way back up to 6th. It was a good ride from him, really.
Yeah, it was. It's a completely different tactic, isn't it? It's a completely different race. It's a different mindset. And I think you saw Max Biaggi's face in particular, Loris Caparossi's face. There was a lot of concern. Even Valentino Rossi, who smiled at the camera and kissed the lens and everything. There's a lot of concern there, isn't there? Right. This is the race that counts for nothing. But this is a race I hope you're going to get on tape one day, because it is MotoGP. It's motorsport at its absolute, absolute
Ben. It was Valentino Rossi who got the whole shot, of course, and he was put under early pressure by Max Biaggi and Makoto Tomada, the two bright yellow Camel Hondas. But Rossi led the way over the opening exchanges. But what a race. These two Hondas really putting him under pressure, especially with that extra horsepower down this long, long straight, over a kilometre in length. We saw Biaggi there. Looking at the replay of that, I thought we saw that during the race. He went over the grass just slightly as he came off the King at the end of 200 miles an hour. Quite incredible as he tried to get the inside line.
I'm just going to break in there and let everyone at home watch this race unfold. I'm just down here with Irv Kanemoto. Now, for all those fans of Suzuki, Irv, can you just explain what the problem was with Kenny Roberts' bike, obviously, who had to retire from the race?
We're not sure. We're checking it right now, but it just slowed up. So now, but right now we're checking all the data and trying to figure out what actually caused the thing. But it just started to slow up.
If I can say so, one of the finest tuners that has probably been around in this paddock. What's going to be going through all those chief mechanics' heads down there? What are the considerations now?
Oh, well, it's going to have to be some sort of guess on what the weather's going to be like with, what, six laps, isn't it, now? Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what they pull up to the start line with.
So they have,
I wouldn't want to be one of the people trying to make that decision, but it's quite exciting.
Yeah, unfortunately, I won't be making that decision, but even the top tuners say it's a bit of a guess. Back up to you guys.
Yeah, guess it is. Let's just remind you, the race has been stopped because of the rain. It was a magnificent race, resulting in a head-to-head between Valentino Rossi and Sete Gibernau that had, I would think, everybody in the stadium here on their feet, everybody throughout the world on their feet, just watching it, because it was so, so exciting. But the rain came down, as are the new rules that came into being last year. That means that there's going to be a completely new race. Forget what you've just seen. Going to be a new race of just six laps. You take a gamble on the tyres, fuel load, everything else. You don't change the tyres once you get out there, because the race will not be stopped. So you have to take the gamble on exactly what the race conditions are going to be. We look out of the commentary box window, it still looks a bit drizzly out there, but the track, Gavin, I don't know if you can see it really, doesn't look that wet, and that's going to make the choice even worse. I think they'd like it to absolutely just pour with rain, really, wouldn't they?
I think it's wet enough. I think that's something. It's not going to be slicks. They're not going to be going out on that. That's for certain. There's enough big drops falling here for them to choose something, and it's going to sit on top, of course, remember. It's going to be greasy because the rain's just fallen on top of a hot track. That water's just going to sit on top of there, and it's just going to make things greasy. So cut slick to intermediates. I don't know. What's quite interesting at the moment, this isn't something the riders prepare for. This isn't something that they're used to. And just how the different riders are reacting. Capirossi's up on his feet, talking to all his mechanics. Meanwhile, in the other half of the Ducati garage, there's Troy Bayliss has sat there with his wife and his personal trainer, just massaging out his hands and just making sure he's relaxed enough. Sete Gibernau sat by himself, focused in a corner. Other people are looking at their bike, making changes to it. It's such an incredible and such a strange situation for all of them that I don't know if anybody really knows how to handle it or psych themselves up for it. It's going to be a very, very interesting six-lap shootout. And I suppose that's what the idea of this rule is, to make it an exciting finish to the race for everyone watching.
Here we are. Here's the starting grid, the new starting grid. Rossi, Gibernau, Max Biaggi on that front row. They were the guys battling for the lead, while Gibernau and Rossi in particular.
Alex Barros, watch out for him from the second row. Marco Melandri and Troy Bayliss in sixth place.
The third row, Norik Abbey, Colin Edwards and Rubens Chaus, who's had a very, very good ride indeed.
Whereas Capirossi in 10th place, followed by Neil Hodgson, the World Superbike champion, and Alex Hoffman. He's doing well on the Kawasaki as well.
Fifth row, Shane Byrne, Jeremy McWilliams' teammate, and Nobuatsu Aoki on the Proton KR machine.
And then on the sixth row, Andrew Pitt and Mikel Ferrizio. Andrew Pitt riding the Moriwaki this weekend, the first of five wildcard appearances after he was dumped by this team the end of last season. Kawasaki, rather unceremoniously, and he wasn't very happy about that either. Andrew Pitt was saying yesterday that he would be very, very satisfied indeed if he could beat one of those Kawasakis in the five wildcard appearances they've got planned for this year.
Right, the riders now have 5 minutes. You can hear that hooter sounding. That's just warning them. They've got 5 minutes to leave the pit lane and join up on this grid. What I'm going to try and do is walk down this pit lane, see if we can get some idea about what the top guys are using, alongside Max Biaggi's garage and the Honda garage of Alex Barros. And we'll try and get some idea of what these guys are using. There have been tyre changes while I've been walking up and down. They've got both bikes are fitted up, probably with different sorts of tyres. And it's going to be very interesting to see what they go out with. But they've now got 5 minutes to get out of here and get round and form that grid up.
And what about the weather, Gavin? We can see there's still some umbrellas up there. Is it actually raining still, or has it stopped?
It probably is in another part of the circuit. It isn't here in pit lane, but there's some horrible, dirty black cloud just behind where you're commentating, behind that massive paddock building just there. They really don't know what's going to happen. There's winds here. It's swirling around the amphitheatre that is Mugello, and nobody knows what's going to happen. It's a complete gamble. Maybe someone further down the grid, like Colin Edwards, can take that gamble. Maybe that gamble can pay off. We're going to see it all now in the next few minutes.
That's just what I was thinking. If you wanted a bit of a wild card bet, who would you put your money on? Obviously, Biaggi, Gibernau and Rossi are going to be there or thereabouts. There's Barros. It's well, who's going to make that big run? It's just for six laps. They're going to absolutely go for it. Somebody who hasn't got a lot to lose. Marco Melandri.
Yeah.
Troy Bayliss, even. Alex Barros. Somebody like that. I know Matthew's got a big leaning towards Marco Melandri. But somebody who's really got little to lose could have a real go. And there we are. There's, we can just seeing a confirmation. That's Troy Bayliss's Ducati with those hand-cut slicks going out there at the moment. And I would think, from what Gavin says about the conditions, that's going to be the preferred choice. But the rain could absolutely pour down in the next six laps. The sun could come out. It changes here so quickly and dry the track out a little bit. It is a gamble. The riders are going out. Who's made the best gamble?
Yeah, that's a full wet front for Sete Gimenao. No doubt about that one. Now he might just decide on a last-minute change there. He's not too sure, is he, Sete Gimenao? Heads back into the box because the sun, as far as I can see, the sun's breaking through again here. And as you rightly said, Nick, that can dry the track very, very quickly. Those conditions would just radically change. And but yeah, as I said before, I think, well, it's such a gamble. Depends on the tyres, obviously. But someone like Marco Melandri, who's ridden so well, you know, he's sort of tamed that side of him where he's just gone gung-ho at it all the time. And he's starting to pick up some really solid results. He was riding really sensibly here today. But now, when he just sees Valentino Rossi in front of him there on that grid, he might just fancy it.
Well, well, well. Max Biaggi has a slick front tyre on. He's about to come out of the pit lane. It is dry in the pit lane at the moment. I'm talking about the air. The track isn't so dry. There are drops being formed, but maybe they just feel that there's not enough water on the track to warrant having any kind of different tyre on. He's just coming out now, and he's got a slick rear on as well. So Max Biaggi is taking that gamble.
And I think Valentino Rossi, we just saw his bike momentarily, may have had slick tyres on. Sete Gimenao, though, without a doubt, has got a wet front and I think probably a cut slip on the rear. Now, let's have a look. Here's Valentino Rossi's bike. Of course, that looks like a slick on the front.
Or yeah, it's a slick on the front, isn't it?
It's not a tyre warmer, is it? That's very interesting indeed. And they're looking all the time upwards. This is very exciting and it's great, but it's a sad, sad way to end such a fantastic race that was just unfolding to a close that even old Mick Doohan wouldn't give us an answer to, would he? That's pretty unusual. Mick usually calls it absolutely right, but he didn't that time. That looks like a rear slick also, Valentino Rossi. So we only got a little glimpse, but I think Rossi is on slicks.
Of course, they can all change on the grid, of course, which can make things even harder for us to gauge. They're all bringing out spare tyres, of course, onto the grid. So that's something, that's a possibility that we have to bear in mind. They'll get this lap to go around and have a look at the track. But we're going to see now. We're going to see what's going to happen as they start to form up. Troy Bayliss and Alex Barros, the first to make it onto the grid. Bayliss has got a cut rear tyre, an intermediate rear tyre and a front slick. Alex Barros is on full slicks on front and rear.
And I'm pretty certain Sete Gimenao is on a... Ooh, definitely a cut slick rear tyre and I think a wet weather tyre at the front, but let's just wait and see, because I think, as you so rightly say, they're sounding it out on this lap and they can change when they come back.
Even the Michelin engineers are talking between themselves saying, what have you done? What have you done to your guy? What have they put on their bike? Troy Bayliss is changing his rear now. I'm sure he's going to put on a slick. It's pretty dry out here on the front straight. It's a real tough decision for all the riders. Obviously, safety is the main reason why we have this rule, of course.
Okay, we're just being told there are going to be two warm-up laps. Two warm-up laps, I would imagine, so the riders can get a better feel of the conditions. So two warm-up laps. We're just looking down on the grid. It's not chaos. That's being unfair to everybody, but there's a lot of people looking pretty worried and a lot of discussions going on among a lot of people. This isn't the time for personalities on the grid. This is the time to make big decisions. Jerry Burgess there talking to Valentino Rossi. I think he's just told him, hasn't he? I hope he's told him that with those two fingers going up there.
You say peace.
Peace, yeah. That there's two warm-up laps. Rossi looks happy. Gimenao, without a doubt, has he made the change? Look at that rear tyre. That is not a slick tyre, is it? What does Gimenao do? He leaves the World Championship. They're taking it out.
They're taking that one out, Nick. Yeah. They've got the slick tyre and the tyre warmer just next to the bike. It has stopped raining, and those dark, heavy clouds have moved on. The problem is, you know, here at Mugello, well, a problem and an advantage, as it turns out in this case, that the clouds just sweep across here so quickly. Yesterday afternoon, we had dry qualifying in 125, MotoGP in 250, and then we had the Boxer Cup race, and then within about 10 minutes, It was flooded here. That's there was right. a big, thick black cloud. It was absolutely soaking. By the time we left to the hotel last night, it was a clear sky again. It was absolutely unbelievable. And that seems to be what's happened here. Just a small cloud has drifted across, dropped its load and moved on. And now it looks as though the conditions are almost dry once again. Gav, if I'm not mistaken, it stopped raining out there.
It stopped raining, but I always have this habit, don't I, of bringing bad news.
Yeah.
It's just some clouds over on the right-hand side. Looking out of your commentary box, which is looking out, would be the way that the riders are looking down the straight at the moment. Looking over that hill there, there's clouds, there's fog, there's rain, obviously, over there. And someone's got to take a gamble, I feel. I think a lot of them are going with slick tyres. Maybe it's for the likes of Bayliss or Melandri or someone like that to take a gamble and maybe stick on a cut slick front. Because I think, this is from my weather experience, of course, that there could be rain here. There could be something here in the air.
Yeah, perhaps it's for somebody a bit further down the grid to say, right, I'm not going to have a good race if they're all on slicks. I'm going to take a big gamble. Yeah. And that could be somebody perhaps a bit further down the grid, the likes of Hodgson, even Caparossi, McWilliams, Byrne, Aoki, somebody like that, Hoffman. You might just say, well, Michel. If it slicks, it's going to be no good. I'm going to take a big gamble and hope it rains.
Yeah, Michel Fabrizio could be the man to do that at his home race on that WCM. Finished 10th in the rain at Jerez.
Certainly did.
You never know.
Michel Fabrizio at the moment doesn't seem to have formed up the grid. I'm not sure he's going to be starting this part of the race. There's Nobuatsu Aoki on the back of the fifth row, and then the sixth row, just the Moriwaki of Andrew Pitt. So maybe the WCM team unable to produce the bike to get on the grid at the moment. Just try and check that one out.
It does appear weather-wise that the decision for the top men has been made for them in many ways, doesn't it? It has dried out. There's a bit of watery sunshine about. Look at Max Biaggi's face. Not only got to ride the flipping monsters, you've got to do the weather forecast as well. That is very hard. I think that face sums up what is happening.
Yeah, I was reading an article in the Italian press with Max Biaggi. They asked him if he was a movie star, who would he be? He said Johnny Depp. And a superhero, he said he'd be Captain America. And he could need a Captain America style performance here as he shoots from that outside of the front row. He's going to come under pressure from Melandri, Barros, Bayliss behind him, Rossi and Gibber now in front. We've got 3 minutes to go. And this is a real hearts in mouth time, not only for the riders and teams, also for the fans banked here around the circuit. And as you said before, Nick, after that crash for Shinya Nakano at the end of the straight, that's the last thing that we want.
I'm putting some money on someone making a gamble here. The wind is coming headlong into the straight, so there'll be a headwind for the riders, but it's bringing along with it some really horrible clouds, and you can see them moving. You can't even see the back hill now at the end of the straight. That I'm certain there's going to be rain. I don't want there to be rain, of course. I want this to be a clean fight down to the line, but it looks like there's got to be someone to take a gamble further down. But even on the likes of Arbe Edwards and Ruben Schaus on that third row of the grid, there's no gambles being taken there. They're all on front and rear slick tyres. Same with Loris Capirossi, Neil Hodgson and Alex Hoffman back there as well, all on slick tyres. So yeah, it looks like everyone's just gone for the slick tyres and no one's thought of that gamble. Maybe they just feel that the risk isn't worth it.
I think we can just get a glimpse there, really, past the rear end of Valentino Rossi's bike, of some cloud. We can't weather forecast from up here. It's still a little bit of sunshine about, but the gambles are not being taken, are they? They've all decided, the top men, they're going to use slicks. I can't believe that just somebody further down the field is not going to take the gamble and have a go for it. Max Biaggi looking very, very tense indeed.
Just earlier about that Shinya Nakano crash you just mentioned there, I just wonder, right in the middle of the straight, I just wonder if it was a problem with the Bridgestone tyres. In a couple of times in the pre-season testing we were at, we saw Kenny Roberts and Makoto Tomada both had tyre blowouts while travelling at high speeds. There was Kenny Roberts while he was in Sepang, and he flew right past the left ear of Jerry McWilliams going into that final hairpin, probably at about 160, 170 miles an hour when his rear tyre went. The same happened as well to Makoto Tomada down the front straight there at Sepang. I just wonder if that's what happened to Shinya Nakano. And just to let you know as well about Michele Fabrizio, he will start from pit lane. He will rejoin, he will form the grid at the back, but he's starting the warm-up laps from pit lane.
Could be the case that with Nakano, maybe that was the debris that we saw the track marshals moving from the straight right in front of us here. Could have been pieces of rubber. That's certainly what it looked like.
Just as well, Mitchell Fabrizio has shod his bike with full wet.
There we go.
There you go. He's the man to watch. I almost wanted to rain now to see Michelle Fabrizio come through.
What's the number of that bookie in High Wycombe? If you were a clever betting man, you'd get £100 or $100 on there straight away. You might lose it, but there's a chance you could win some unbelievable money. There he is, 17th on the grid. He's taking the gamble, and I don't blame him. I got to say, just looking out of the window, it's quite sunny at the moment. I do hope it remains dry.
For those watching us on delayed, it's too late.
Here we go. Two warm-up laps.
Two warm-up laps for these guys to check out the conditions. For the moment, they're pretty much dry. There is Mikel Fabrizio, the man we're talking about, and you can see those full wets there. He starts from pit lane, and he will be praying for rain, and so will his fans, and so will his team boss, Peter Clifford, a very experienced team, of course. Grand Prix winners with the Red Bull Yamaha setup that they used to have with Gary McCoy and Regis Laconi, both winning races for them, and Simon Crafar before that, of course. But I'm sure that they will have, they're a canny team. Peter Clifford knows what he's doing, and he's obviously recognised that their chance here is to put full wets on, pray for rain. And you can see a few spots there still on our helicopter camera.
Just what I was going to say, Matthew, is that spots or dirt on the camera? It could just be a few spots of rain. It's not dirt on our television screen.
No, I'm sure. You would have to pay me a lot of money to lean down and wipe the rain from the front of that helicopter camera, Nick. Yeah. So they might be there from the previous rain.
I'm just down here on pit wall with Nicky Hayden. Nicky crashed out of that first part of the race, then had to retire. Just explain to us what happened then.
Yeah, I was right there, and I felt really comfortable there. And Melandri and me went back and forth a couple times, and the group started to get away, and I felt like I could run the pace today. Finally, I passed him back and was just charging after that group and crashed. I mean, I just pretty well told myself I wasn't going to watch them disappear today, and I was going to go for it, and that's what happened. Unfortunately, I fell off, but I'm okay. I only got to think about it for a week, so at least we get another crack at them at Barcelona, and we'll go for it again.
Now, what about this part of the race, the second half? What tough decisions for the riders to make? They all seem to have gone with slicks. Apart from one guy right at the back who's on wet tyres, Fabrizio. Would you have taken a gamble or just gone down the line with a slicks? There's clouds around, but what would you say?
Yeah, I mean, I would have went slicks, but a guy like Fabrizio. Loud. You forget how loud they are when you're out there. Yeah, I mean, it's going to be a good race. Unfortunately, my clutch was rattling, so I came in, and we'll see.
Okay, thanks very much for talking to us, Nicky.
I'm intrigued by these helicopter shots. You're quite right, of course, Matthew. They wouldn't get out and clean the camera. I don't think they are spots of rain. Very interesting to hear Nicky Hayden, wasn't it? And he could have been a good man in a six-lap shootout, couldn't he? Just up his street, I would have thought. Short, sharp, go for it. It would have been good. We ride with Max Biaggi. Biaggi again, I think, could be a man. There, cause a few surprises.
There are spots of rain.
Oh, my golly.
There are spots of rain in the pit lane at the moment as they're coming down here. Now, I'm just wondering if the riders can come into the pit lane, if they can see the spots of rain, if they can come in and change, because at the end of the day, it's a safety issue. I'm just wondering if that is a possibility, because light rain is falling in pit lane.
We don't see two warm-up laps ever, really, do we? I mean, this is the thing at this stage, do we?
No, and usually after one warm-up lap, you can come in, change your tyres and start from pit lane. And we saw that actually at Le Mans last year. You may remember Olivier Jacques was one of the guys, and Max Biaggi, who started the race from pit lane after just making that last-minute decision on their warm-up lap.
Right, so basically, I reckon we're going to have most of them coming into pit lane. They're all preparing the spare bikes. Mikel Fabrizio is out there with a full set of wet tyres on. Now, I'm not sure whether they're going to come in. I don't know whether you can see if they're coming in. I can't see if they're coming into pit lane at the moment. But we could have one rider on the grid.
Well, they don't seem to be showing too much concern at the moment there. Valentino Rossi just doing his customary rearranging order, but before removing his strip visor. But he don't seem to be showing too much concern out there. But if that was the case, that would be...
They're changing the tyres on the spare bikes that are in the pit lane at the moment. They're changing the tyres. Definitely on Alex Barros's. They're taking his rear tyre out at the moment. Just to look down, other people are preparing the spare bikes, and they're coming into pit lane now.
A couple of people are coming into pit lane, Gav, but I can tell you the majority, we can see them from our commentary box, are just lining up on the grid. There's a few gaps. There's going to be a few people starting from pit lane, a few people starting from the grid. There's Jeremy McWilliams. He's getting on the wet tyres. He's one of those guys at the back of the grid who knows he can take a gamble and hope for rain. There's a few gaps. Let's see the front row. Valentino Rossi is there. Gibernau is there. Biaggi is there. They're all on wets. They want to get out and get away as quick as they can while this track's dry. Barros, Melandri and Bayliss are all there. Then behind them, it's Arbe, Edwards, Joust. They're all there. In fact, I think it's really only Jeremy McWilliams who's returned to change those tyres.
Only McWilliams is starting from the pit lane at the moment, but more rain is falling. It's a tough decision, this one. It's like a casino game, this.
Right, six laps, the Italian Grand Prix, conditions not good. What a gamble they have taken. Six lap shootout, we're underway, and it's a good start, it looks like, by Max Biaggi. Biaggi leads the way as they race up towards the first right-hander.
What about Norikabe coming through the field as well there? Norikabe, in fact, it is who takes a gamble into the first corner on those slick tyres, and it's slick track as well because the rain has been falling, and it's Norikabe who leads the way.
Abe leads, Biaggi second, Rossi third, Gibernau and Barros also there. I think we're probably riding with Gibernau here. That's Alex Barros just behind him.
In fact,
it's Valentino Rossi, I would say, with the exhaust there. But Norikabe, there we are. We said there was somebody who's going to take a big gamble by absolutely going for it. Is it going to be Norikabe?
Norikabe hasn't won a Grand Prix since Japan at the start of the 2000 season. Look out for Alex Barros there as well, lurking in fourth place. Marco Melandri is behind him, so is Troy Bayliss. And Michel Fabrizio is nowhere to be seen on those wet tyres, it has to be said. So the track's still fairly dry at the moment. Alex Barros up on the inside of Rossi into third place. Rossi now fourth, Gibernau fifth. Gibernau just getting back up on the inside of Rossi, though, to steal back to fourth.
You get the feeling Rossi really is testing those conditions. He's not prepared to stick his neck out just at the moment. He just wants to see exactly how the track is. This is going to be six laps. The first race, which was an absolute cracker, was stopped because of the rain. This is a six-lap shootout to decide the winner of the Italian Grand Prix here at Mugello. Biaggi now moving up on the inside of Norikabe. Though we ride with that Valentino Rossi. We ride as we just look with Sete Gibernau, who's been relegated back by Rossi. So Gibernau back behind Rossi, but it's Norikabe that leads the way.
Alex Barros just stealing through there to take the lead. Sorry, Gav.
Just to say, rain is still falling down here on the straight. I don't know what it is doing around the rest of the track. Here in pit lane, rain is still falling. And I can't believe that on slick tyres they can risk too much because it's just greasy on top.
Alex Barros and Max Biaggi get around each side of Norikabe as they hit the end of the straight. Still there, hitting 200 miles an hour. Norikabe up on the brakes on the inside of Barros. Here comes Gibernau on the inside of Abe. But it's Barros who takes second place. Now a man running straight there is that Marco Melandri on the Yamaha. I think it was. But Max Biaggi now has seen the red mist. He's firing away at the front. Alex Barros is in second there. And the riders really sat up now, Nick. They're not getting their knee fully down, as you can see. They're taking it very, very carefully indeed. Here comes Troy Bayliss. The rain is really falling now.
It's Barros that leads the way. Gibernau second, Bayliss third, Biaggi fourth. Rubens Chaus right up there. We could get an absolute surprise, couldn't we? Because these top men aren't prepared to stick their necks out on slick tyres in the rain. They can't change the race conditions. The race cannot be stopped. And Valentino Rossi, without a doubt, has decided, I'm not going to get up there at the front in these conditions. Who can blame them?
It's really throwing it down now here. It's fine rain, but it really is soaking the track at the moment. And those guys on slicks really better be careful. We don't want any accidents. We don't want anything. They just...
Gav, Ruben Joust has just gone through to the front. Ruben Joust fancies his chances in these conditions. He's on slick tyres too. Here comes Alex Barros. Oh, Alex Barros back in front of Joust. Joust back in front of Barros, sorry. Wowee. Ruben Joust leads a Grand Prix for the first time in his career. He made his MotoGP debut at the start of this season in the first round in South Africa. Here comes Troy Bayliss as well around the outside. The old Superbike boys really fancying it in these conditions. Now Bayliss getting around the outside. He gets up the inside this time of Alex Barros. Bayliss up to second place.
Oh dear. Right, Fabrizio is currently in 14th place. Let's keep a look at it. But Rubens Joust he's going away. He's got the, well, I won't say the word to do it, in the rain, on the slick tyres. He could win an extraordinary race here. There's four and a half laps to go.
The rain is really pouring down. If he's on slick tyres, if anyone's on slick tyres, it may even make enough sense to come into to pit lane because and change tyres if he can, because it really is lashing down. I can't believe they're going 200 miles an hour down the end of that straight with slick tyres on in these conditions.
I think something just kicked up off the track there. Not sure what that was. A couple of riders getting a mouthful of it, whatever, at the back. Here comes Troy Bayliss giving Jouce a few problems. Jouce just hangs on, and it's so true, isn't it? Look at him getting the knee round these corners on slick tyres on 240 brake horsepower machines. And a slick track, probably just as slick as the tyres are. It's quite phenomenal. We're watching out for Michel Fabrizio coming through on those wet Dunlop tyres in 14th place, of course. He's now lapping in there, 208. That's around, 4 or 5 seconds slower, actually, than the lead group at the moment. So these guys have just been managed to keep their pace up at the front. But the longer this rain comes down, the more difficult it's going to get for them.
Here comes Bayliss up the inside, and Bayliss takes the lead. Troy Bayliss leads the Italian Grand Prix momentarily because Rubisauce is back inside him. And they're absolutely side by side, but it's Bayliss that now holds the advantage. Out in second place. Here comes Gibbonau up the inside of the house. He's bringing Alex Barros with him. The MotoGP boys have decided they better fight back, but Troy Bayliss is absolutely flying at the front with 3.5 laps to go. What an extraordinary race, and what a performance by the Australian.
Alex Barros now second, Gibbonau third. Rossi just shifts up to fourth ahead of Jouce. Then it's Biaggi. And then there's a surprise Aprilia at the back of there. It's Shaky Byrne joining in the fun as well. Shaky Byrne, the British Superbike champion, won 2 rounds of the World Superbike Series at Brands Hatch last year. And he's getting involved in this fight at the front.
It stopped raining. The sun's coming out. I'm not joking at all. It stopped raining at the moment down the main straight, but the track is still sodden.
Here comes Shane Byrne around the outside of Ruben Jouce, and he fancies it now with Valentino Rossi. Shane Byrne making his name amongst the MotoGP big boys. Down the straight they come. Troy Bayliss has a clear lead of around 1.161 seconds from Sete Gibbonau in second. Now then, on the brakes at the end of the straight, it's Rossi and Biaggi just shift past Gibbonau. Alex Barros is there. Byrne just runs it a little bit wide. It's so hard to see what's going on from that helicopter camera, but there's a slight gap between Bayliss and Rossi. Then it's Biaggi in third place. Then it's Gibbonau. Then it's Barros, Jouce, and then a slight gap now to Shane Byrne.
Rossi's tested the conditions. He's decided he's going to have a go. There's 2.75 laps to go. Sensationally, Troy Bayliss, the Australian, the former World Superbike, the former British champion, leads the way. He's taken the gamble in the conditions. He's riding quite brilliant, but Rossi is now closing. Rossi second, Gibbonau third, Biaggi four, Barros five, Shane Byrne in sixth place, the British Superbike champion, and Rossi leads the way. Rossi and Bayliss, we've seen them exchange blows or have some great races last season, especially I remember in South Africa at Velcom. But Rossi really has grabbed the bull by the horns in these conditions, and it's Rossi that leads the way. And Jerry Burgess, his crew chief, cannot believe it. Here comes Gibbonau. He's not going to let Rossi get away with this. It's a 6-lap shootout after the Italian Grand Prix was stopped because of the rain. They're all on slick tyres. It poured with rain at one point. It's now drying out. Rossi leads. The crowd go wild. Bayliss second. Gibbonau third. Biaggi four. Jouce doing a brilliant job in fifth place, and it looks like Shane Shaky Byrne in sixth.
Rossi there just putting his foot down to just check the exact state of the track surface. Interesting stuff there from the world champion, and they just bunch up slightly closer together now as well. It's all there for them. You just wonder what's going through the minds of people like Ruben Jouce and Shane Byrne. They know they're not going to be in this position again, surely, for the rest of the season. They're right up there. And with, 2 laps to go now as they come side by side down the straight, the Ducati of Troy Bayliss has the edge over the Yamaha of Valentino Rossi at the end of the straight, but Rossi is bravest on the brakes. That Yamaha has looked so stable at the end of the straight all through the race. Remember earlier on with Marco Melandri as well in the dry, and Valentino Rossi, it does just seem to have the advantage into that right-hander. But Bayliss, no doubt about it, has got the horsepower advantage coming down the straight now.
He certainly has. With 1.75 laps to go, we ride with Valentino Rossi. Troy Bayliss behind him, and Bayliss showed exactly what his intentions are on that previous lap. He showed that if he can be close enough, he thinks he can out-drag Valentino Rossi to the line. What a sensational result that would be for Troy Bayliss if he could win this race. That's the gap. Sete Gibernau closes on Bayliss. Bayliss still hangs on to second place. Gibernau third, just Max Biaggi four. In fifth place, Rubens Chaus is having a magnificent ride at that number 11. And he's gone past Max Biaggi, Rubens Chaus, riding the 2003 Ducati. But Rossi leads. Bayliss coming under real pressure now from Sete Gibernau. Gibernau getting quicker and quicker as he sorts out the conditions. He doesn't want to lose that World Championship lead, but he's moved now into second place. Can he mount any sort of challenge against Valentino Rossi? Oh, here comes Chaus, pushes Bayliss out of the way. Wow, one and a quarter laps to go.
Ruben Jouse had a bone to pick with Troy Bayliss after Bayliss crashed in front of him in Jerez in the wet there. But Jouse wasn't too happy about that one, but he's got his own back now as he moves up to third place. Could Ruben Jouse get his first ever Grand Prix podium here in Italy? Shane Byrne has lost touch with this group and he's coming under pressure now from Noricabi and Loris Capirossi just behind him. Shane Byrne showing glimpses of the talent that's propelled him into MotoGP from British Superbikes just last season.
One lap to go for Valentino Rossi, the Italian superstar. 3.259 miles between him and his third consecutive victory here at the Italian Grand Prix at Mugello. A superb performance by him. Sete Gibernau, I don't think, can probably catch him. Max Biaggi in third place, Troy Bayliss four, Rubens Chaus five, Alex Barros in sixth place. He's done it again, Valentino Rossi. He rode a superb race with Sete Gibernau before the rain came down in the dry, in the difficult conditions. He just felt the conditions. He saw his boot go out on the track a couple of times. Gibernau is closing, but I don't think he's going to be close enough.
Yeah, the conditions just getting gradually better. I think a dry line forming on the circuit. The lap times have been getting quicker and quicker and quicker. And Rossi's time of 155.776 was the fastest lap. Alex Barros actually just went slightly quicker at 155.701, but certainly some sort of dry line has been forming there, and that's just allowed these guys to shake off the likes of Shane Byrne.
Half a lap to go for Valentino Rossi and that hat-trick of wins. Rossi leads, Gibernau second, Biaggi third, Bayliss, Chaus, Biaggi, Barros. That's Biaggi in third place. Troy Bayliss desperate to try and get onto the podium in fourth place. But what a ride by the 25-year-old Italian. It'd be his 61st Grand Prix victory. And really, you just wonder where it will end. He's absolutely got the bit between the teeth now. I think he's found a drier line. He knows that Sete Gibernau is closing. Full master Gibernau is pushing him all he knows, isn't he, Sete Gibernau? They're coming into the left-hander, Pacini, for the very last time. Just the start and finish straight in front of Valentino Rossi as he accelerates the Yamaha away. The checkered flag beckons. Valentino Rossi scores a hat-trick of victories here at the Italian Grand Prix at Mugello. Sete Gibernau second, Max Biaggi third, Troy Bayliss four, Rubens Chaus five, Alex Barros six, Norik Abe seven, Loris Capirossi eight, Marco Melandri nine, and Shane Byrne in 10th place, Neil Hodgson 11, Colin Edwards 12, and Nobuatsu Aoki in 13th place.
Valentino Rossi's army of fans finally get a chance to celebrate, and I suppose in a way justice was done here. Rossi, Gibernau, Biaggi, the three fastest men in race one, the three fastest men in race two. There were no crashes, thankfully, as well. And these riders, absolute professionals, the best riders in the world, picking their way through really difficult conditions to cross the line safely. Shane Byrne enjoyed himself there on the Aprilia, didn't he? Mixing it up with the front runners for the first time in his Grand Prix career. I'm sure we'll see him back again in the future. But no doubt about the number one, Valentino Rossi, the reigning world champion, takes five important points back off the early championship leader, Sete Gibernau.
What an afternoon. What an incredible day's racing. What a MotoGP event. Fabulous race in the dry between Valentino Rossi and Sete Gibernau. Nobody knew how that one was going to end up. Then the rain came down. A six-lap shootout. We saw Ruben Chaus leading the way. We saw Troy Bayliss leading the way. But at the end, as the track just started to dry, it was the MotoGP men at the front, headed by the world champion, Valentino Rossi. Second place, Sete Gibernau, the championship leader. And in third place, his fourth consecutive podium, Max Biaggi. great ride by Bayliss and Kaus. Barros, Abe, Caparossi, Melandri. Good ride by Shane Byrne into 10th place. Neil Hodgson, 12th. Colin Edwards, 12th, sorry. Nobuatsu Aoki, 13th. Alex Hoffman in 14th. And Fabrizio, with those wet weather tyres, picks up a point in 15th place.
That Giovinazzi salutes the Mugello crowd after taking second place. He continues to lead the MotoGP World Championship, but his advantage has been cut back by Valentino Rossi. Rossi, by my calculations, is going to be level, or in fact ahead of Max Biaggi in second place in the championship. Biaggi relegated to third, and he now lies 10 points behind Seto Giovinazzi in the early standings.
What more can you say about this 25-year-old Italian? 125 champion, 250 champion, 500cc world champion, MotoGP world champion, switches to Yamaha, four races gone, he's won two of them, and he's second in the championship, just 10 points behind Seto Giovinazzi. Don't do anything next Sunday afternoon. We're in Barcelona, and I tell you, if it's as good as it's been this afternoon, it will be fantastic.
Well, I believe the weather reports this weekend from Barcelona are hot and sunny. People we know back there are on the beach. Let's just hope that it stays that way for next weekend. We don't want rain like we had today. We were treated to an absolute feast of motorcycle racing. The 125, 250 and MotoGP classes have all been fantastic. Just really slightly taking the shine off with that little shower at the end of the MotoGP race. But well, you couldn't have asked for much more drama and excitement here at Mugello, and these men certainly provided it.
Beaming smile for Troy Bayliss as he comes into the pits. I bet he didn't start the day thinking he'd get a fourth place finish, did he at all? Kiss from his wife, Kim, of course. We'll see if we can get a word with Troy Bayliss after what was an unexpected result, I think, for the Ducati.
Valentino Rossi, he's done it again. Yamaha cannot believe what they have done. They've signed on the king. He's riding like a king. He's second in the championship. He's won them two Grand Prix. Okay, it was certainly not a hollow victory. It was disappointing that the race with Giovinazzi didn't end in the dry. But Rossi showed once again, and his pit crew, they made all the right decisions. And he rode as we know he is. He's a true world champion.
Rossi getting absolutely mobbed. The man at the front there is the leader of his fan club, and they are no more evident in any other part of the world than they are here in Italy, despite the branches in Australia and England and all the rest of it, Spain. I'm sure that they have enjoyed themselves today. What a performance it was from Rossi in both conditions. Excellent second performance from Troy Bayliss as well, just to prove that it's not him that's underperforming this season. It's his bike. They've had so many problems at Ducati, but Bayliss once again showing that undoubted talent on the Ducati Cosmo Sedici. Well, I think that Valentino Rossi is going to have to put up with a bit more of that this evening, isn't he? There will be every man and his dog wanting to give him their personal congratulations.
And isn't it typical? The sun is now shining, the clouds are clearing away. And there we are. Max Biaggi, I think, would be a bit disappointed to be relegated to third place in the championship behind Valentino Rossi, but he's finished on the podium at every race so far. Seto Giovinazzi, I don't think he'd be too disappointed to finish second. He could have well won the race if it hadn't rained, but he still leads the championship, 10 points in front of Rossi, with Biaggi in third place, a further 4 points adrift.
I'm just down here in pit lane at the moment with Troy Bayliss finishing fourth place. Just tell us, Troy, literally, how dangerous was it out there at the end?
Well, I was just talking to my guys, like, I'm not scared, but I'm telling you, I don't want that situation again, because people were really lucky out there, and when it comes to things like this, I'm not very outspoken, but right now I'll say, and I'm sure everybody will agree that was out there, was not the right thing to do. That's it.
Before the weekend began, or maybe before the race began at least, you wouldn't be thinking about a fourth place. Any positives that you can take from this weekend now that maybe the 2003 bike has been discarded to one side?
Well, actually, I came here very confident and really motivated because we had a test in Le Mans which went very well. But then when we arrived, I found myself back in the same situation again. So we've been struggling a bit all weekend, but basically I always rely on myself for the race to put in a big effort. And good job, man. And that was dangerous, though, right? It was impossible. By race day, it is what it is, and you get on and you do what you can do. And the bike was going okay, but we just need to find another step.
Thanks very much, Troy, and well done for that.
Thank you. Cheers.
Troy Bayliss there conversing with Gavin Emmett down in the Ducati pit box and his mechanics at the same time. Why not? Good to hear from Troy. He's now ninth in the championship after finishing fourth in that slippery Italian Grand Prix, and it was a credit to all the riders that they managed to cross the line at the end. No fallers in that second race, which is the big worry before that. As you just heard from the horse's mouth, it was tough going out there.
It was tough going out there, and it was interesting to hear what Troy Bayliss said, that they don't want to be put in that situation again. Yeah, when it rains as it did and then you've got to restart a race or have a completely new race, you're really in a no-win situation, are you? And that was the worst situation you could have ever been in, because you're supposed to make the tyre choice. It was dry and then it started to rain when they went out for that last six laps. You can't come in and stop the race then. It's a no-win situation, but it was very, very dangerous indeed. And I think the riders just showed why they are the top riders in the world.
It's tough to call as well, Nick, because at the end of the day, it's up to the riders whether they choose wet or slick tyres, and you know, the race direction can only do so much about that choice. Anyway, let's relive what was an absolutely stunning Italian Grand Prix. The first dry race was one of the best that you will see anywhere in the world. Valentino Rossi absolutely going for it in the opening stages of the race, leading the way. But what an effort that was, and I tell you what, that does look, as you said, Gav, as though that rear Bridgestone tyre blew out there. There was debris all over the track, wasn't there?
He's conscious in the medical centre, crashing at over 210 miles an hour. It rains. We have a six-lap shootout. All the top riders on slick tyres on a wet track. It really could not be more difficult. Alex Barros led the way. Troy Bayliss flying. Ruben Chaus absolutely flying. The former World Superbike boys prepared to take on the MotoGP men in these conditions. Ruben Chaus leads the Grand Prix from Alex Barros and Sete Givinau. Here comes Troy Bayliss on the Ducati. The Australian leads the way momentarily. Chaus back in front. But this is dangerous because it's a wet track and it's slick tyres. But slowly but surely, the likes of Sete Givinau and in particular Valentino Rossi had his foot down a couple of times to test out the conditions, and he decides it's time to go. Valentino Rossi pulls the trigger on the Yamaha, and there's nothing anybody else can do. Sete Givinau up into second place, Ruben Chaus third, Troy Bayliss fourth, but on the line at the checkered flag. Valentino Rossi wins his third consecutive Italian Grand Prix here at Mugello. Sete Givinau in second place, Max Biaggi third. They deserve all those applause, don't they? They're brave, brave men, not only for the first race where we saw MotoGP at its very, very best, but the second race when it was very, very dangerous indeed. They are waiting, though, for the crowd's hero to arrive. The whole of Italy, the whole of Europe, perhaps the whole of the world, celebrate the greatest motorcycle racer in the world, 25-year-old Valentino Rossi.
Well, the pit lane below us is absolutely packed out with people. They've invaded the track. They listened to the warnings beforehand. There was Valentino Rossi did a TV message to them on the big screens to ask them not to invade the track. But they've done just that at the end. Once the riders are safely back, as you can see, thousands and thousands of fans have spilled down onto the track here in front of the podium. It's making for an incredible atmosphere, incredible scenes here. They've got two Italians on the podium to celebrate with and one Spaniard. Max Biaggi in third place. Givinau celebrates second and retains his championship lead by 10 points from today's winner. Victor at the Italian Grand Prix for the third year in succession, correct me. It's Valentino Rossi.
Oh, what a day for Yamaha as well. But the day belongs to one man. The crowd chant his name. We now wait for the Italian national anthem.
What a noise here at Mugello. It's like being in the middle of a football crowd. The crescendo then for the Italian anthem, which is still being sung, is absolutely unbelievable. I've never seen anything like this at a Grand Prix. It's quite stunning and testament to the performance of possibly the greatest motorcycle racer of all time. Valentino Rossi stands atop the podium, celebrates with a winner's champagne for the second time this season, with Sete Gibernau and Max Biaggi. They shared the wins between them, the two. The top of the rider standings. Gibernau leads by 10 points from Rossi with 4 rounds to go. And we'll be back in 1 week at the Barcelona Grand Prix. Whatever you do, don't miss it.